Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us for this instruction course. We'll be presenting to you today different scenarios that we face as cataract surgeons. This course is a bit different because for a change, the same presenter will be presenting two sides of the same coin instead of two people talking about what they prefer. Because of course, at any given time, we should always have different options. Every patient is different and every eye is different. So our first talk will be by our chief instructor, Dr. Ashok Kumar Mulani, and it will be about the small pupil, management of small pupil.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'll first thank chairman and the organizing committee for inviting us for this session. And we have a lovely group of distinguished speakers who will be joining us on this session. I have no financial interest. I'll be talking on small pupil management. There are various causes of small pupil, which include pseudo-exfoliation and diabetes, chronic meiotic therapy and chronic uveitis, which leads to posterior synechia and small pupils. Other causes include old age, ocular surgery, trauma. You must have also seen when you have a patient of cataract surgery on a particular day and next day you take them to the theater and you find that the pupil does not dilate. It is because of pupillary fatigue which it undergoes, and then you have to use different means to dilate the pupil. Today the most important cause is IFS. What is IFS? It is intraoperative floppy iris syndrome, which includes floppy iris that bellows or balloons in response to normal irrigating currents in the anterior chamber. There is marked tendency for the iris to prolapse from the incisions, which includes the main port and the side incisions. There is progressive pupillary constriction during surgery. IFS occurs due to use of temozolomide or Urimax, which is an alpha-1 receptor antagonist used for benign enlargement of the prostate. It relaxes the muscles of the bladder, neck bladder and dilator muscle in the iris, causes atrophy of the iris dilator muscle and decreased iris tissue rigidity. There are various difficulties incurred during the surgery in small pupil due to poor visualization, like iris damage, a small CCC, which can cause difficulty in removing the nucleus and the nuclear fragments. The small CC can later on also cause capsular phimosis. There may be difficulty in IOL placement and the risk of PCR increases. And if this happens, you have poor visual outcomes and a very unhappy patient. One has to prepare preoperatively in patients of small pupil. Taking history of any medication is very important. During first consultation, observe if the pupil is adequately dilated. If a patient has IFS, one can use atropine twice a day for 3 days pre-op. One can use intraoperative phenocaine or any pharmacology products to dilate the pupil, or you can use OVDs to dilate, called viscomydriasis. My main talk is to compare the use of two mechanical devices, the iris hooks and the pupil expansion devices like the rings. In one of the articles in the JCRS of February 2019 by Nederito and Ursel from UK compared the use of iris hooks and pupil expansion rings, where they found the use of iris hooks took longer surgical time as compared to the expansion rings, while there was more anterior uveitis and corneal edema after the use of expansion rings. However, both were safe to use in minimizing the intraoperative complication in eyes with small pupils. There's another article from the European Journal of Ophthalmology where they compared the use of Malugin ring and iris stretching hooks in narrow pupil. The results showed that the use of Malugin ring made surgery easier and better functional results and less endothelial loss compared to the use of iris hooks. In yet another article from ARVO Meet in 2014, they found patients undergoing use of Malugin ring achieved faster recovery compared to those with iris hooks when they were used. Here is a patient of IFS syndrome where there is a prolapsing of the iris can see the prolapse occurring from the main port, and I'm trying to manage using iris hooks. And whenever you are using iris hooks, you must use them parallel to the iris. If you indent them from the corneal side, you will have tinting of the iris, and the restriction of the management with the obstruction with the instruments will be there. Always put OVD between the iris and the anterior capsule so that you create a space for the iris hooks to be placed there. You can see in this video, in spite of using the iris hooks, putting the phaco probe was difficult because of the floppy syndrome, and the iris was coming in the way of the phaco probe and making the procedure difficult. Here is another case of small pupil where I tried to use intracameral midriatics and viscomidriasis. I stained it with trypan blue, removed it with viscoelastic. Then did capsulorhexis along the pupillary margin. In spite of that, we found the pupil was still small. Then we used a pupillary expansion ring. Here we are using Malugin ring. Always use the distal scroll first and then try and put the lateral and medial scrolls. Here also try and put some viscoelastic between the iris and the anterior capsule so you have some space to put the Malugin ring. After completely putting the capsule, the Malugin ring in all the four places, we have a diamond shape pupil which actually becomes more round because it has an 8-point fixation, and you are able to perform the phaco emulsification uneventfully. Here is another patient of a small pupil with a hard cataract and a white cataract. We were struggling to put the Malugin ring, and during the process we found one of the scroll going under the iris. On the left side, if you see, the scroll is gone under the iris. We were unable to retrieve it. So in this unusual case, we used iris hooks and the Malugin ring together, which is quite unusual. And we were able to perform the cataract surgery uneventfully. Preparing incision for the iris hooks. Don't overpull the iris hooks, otherwise you cause trauma to the pupillary margin. The purpose of showing this case was that it is quite unusual to use both the things in one case, where the whole purpose of using is to perform an uneventful surgery, and this is how we completed. Comparing the iris hooks to pupil expanders like Malugin ring, iris hooks are quite inexpensive, easy to learn. It causes a 4 to 5 point fixation compared to 8 point fixation in the Malugin ring. iris hooks takes longer surgical time, and malugendering is easy to learn. Once you have mastered the technique, it takes minimum time, and you have an 8-point fixation and almost a round pupil. With iris hooks, it causes more stretching and damage to the iris sphincter, while malugendering causes minimal trauma to the pupillary margin. The fluidix causes floppy iris with the iris hooks, while with malugendering you get a vertical stability. With iris hooks, you have additional paracentesis created, while malugendering goes through the main incision. To sum up, malugendering is my preferred pupil expander ring, as it is easy to use and less traumatic compared to iris hooks. I would like to thank my daughter for helping me to prepare this presentation, and thank you all for patient listening. Thank you.
Any questions? How many people in the audience use the Malugan ring? Does anyone reuse the Malugan ring? Sir, how many times do you, and how do you sterilize it? Okay, thank you. So our next speaker is Dr. Kavita Rao, a very established cornea practitioner in Mumbai, and she'll be talking to us about her preferred technique and all the techniques that she uses for secondary IOL implantation.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here at, am I audible? Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here at AIOS and to be part of this wonderful and unique course. I'm going to start out with saying that, you know, in life is everything about just, not in life, but at least in ophthalmology, is it only about, you know, two sides of a coin? But, you know, in reality, when we're actually doing cases, it's really not just, you know, between choosing the heads or tails. It's about, you know, looking at multiple factors. It's more like solving a Rubik cube. And so, sorry, Samita, but you know, it's I'm going to talk more about how it's going to be about solving a Rubik cube and not really about choosing one over the other. So what are the various factors which will come to play or come to mind when you're deciding about a secondary IOL? Let's look at the surgeon factors. Now, what is your expertise? How much, you know, are you willing to, you know, go further and learn about doing maybe a scleral fixator or a glued IOL or maybe a Yamane technique? What is your willingness to adapt? Do you just want to do the older techniques? Do you want to adapt to the newer ones? What are the logistics, you know, at that particular time, if it's happened in your OT, if you had a zone dial at that particular point, what kind of lens is available? Because a three-piece IOL can also be glued versus maybe an iris fixated, which may not be available. Now, looking at the patient factors, what are the factors which may come in place? Of course, whether there's any capsular support. What is the iris tone? That is very important, especially if you're going to debate whether an iris claw can be used. Oftentimes, I've seen that, you know, in the cases where there's difficult cases, the iris tone also may be poor because the patient may have had a pseudo-X, the patient may have had trauma. So that may not really be ideal cases for iris fixated. And also, if the patient has any comorbidities, like maybe a diabetic macular edema, or, you know, patient may need peripheral retinal lasers, where again, maybe an iris fixated may not be ideal. So we have various options available, a three-piece IOL, which can be glued, an SF IOL, an Iridia IOL, iris claw IOL. Just going to cover a few cases. It's mostly just a video-based presentation. I'll start with this first patient. This is a 72-year-old patient. A patient had pseudo-X, and the other eye, the IOL, there was a mild phacodonesis. In this eye, the IOL was completely dislocated in vitreous with the entire bag. So we decided in this patient, in because of the pseudo-X and glaucoma, to not do an iris claw and put an IOL explantation, but then put in a glued IOL in this patient. So the initial part of the surgery was done by the, you know, like after making the flaps, because I work in a, you know, retina center, I first usually make the flaps or the scleral flap and also the flaps for the glued IOL, and then I give the hand over the case to the retina surgeon, who then performs the retinal surgery, and then I take over. So this is the marking which I feel really helps, you know, because you're then making your pots, scleral, the flaps exactly 180 degrees are opposite. I think Dr. Amar Agarwal also has devised a marker which not only marks your, you know, the points, but also the marks the length of the flaps to be made. So here the retinal surgeon is now going in and he's going to do a vitrectomy. Is there any way I can forward this video? I'm just trying to. No, I don't think there's any way to forward that. So as you can see, it's actually the complete bag. It's a one-piece IOL with the bag. So the entire thing was then delivered anteriorly by the surgeon, which was then. And in this case, if it was a three-piece IOL in another scenario at that point, maybe that same IOL can be also tried. You can try and glue the same IOL. But another word of caution, if that IOL's been in the eye for many years, we tried a similar case where a three-piece IOL, we tried to, the same IOL we tried to glue, and, the haptics were not, they were very malleable and they kind of twisted. So again, that could be a factor where you may not want to do that. This is a handshake technique where we are grasping the haptic, which is then pulled out from either end, and I prefer doing this rather than doing the Yamane, because I feel there's a lot of IOL donesses with the Yamane's technique, so I really don't have any case to show of that. What I've seen in literature and what I've seen in other people's cases, so this is then the end of the case. Moving on to the next case, this is a patient, a 65-year-old with a blunt fist trauma to the eye. The patient has a dislocated cataractus lens in the vitreous, and this is not a dilated pupil. This is how it was on presentation. This is a completely damaged sphincter and with an iridodialysis with a cataractus lens in the eye. So for obvious reasons, in this case, we are going to do a an SFIOL with a pupilloplasty. I'm going to just minimize this. This was done on a 3D microscope, which is we've just got, and somehow we've not been able to figure out the editing of the videos and not been able to load it in my PowerPoint. I'll just play the direct video. So this is the video of that patient. Though it shows Dr. Natarajan's name out there, that's he's done the part where he is actually removing the cataractus lens from the vitreous. Here again, as I said, I've made the flaps anteriorly. I'm just going to run through this video. Here he is now making the port with the vitrectomy. As you can see, the entire cataractus lens is in the vitreous. He decided that he can manage this. Sometimes if it's really hard, he delivers it in the anterior chamber, and that's why we remove it. But he somehow felt he can go ahead with phacofragmenting this. He did phacofragmentation of the entire nucleus, and now that's done. And here again, I've taken over. I'm closing that scleral port, and then pretty much what I've done is I've done the railroading technique where I've then put in an SFIOL. I've put in if you see, there are two sutures which I have passed, two proline sutures. One is already in the eye. This is the second one, which are then removed anteriorly from the center. I think there's a repetition. As I said, we are not really clear how to edit that. So yeah, so the IOL is already in the eye here. And when you're tightening these knots on either side, you have to be very careful to not pull too much. That was a tip which I wanted to give. And here, like I said, again, obviously, iris glow cannot be done. We are doing a pupilloplasty. You're passing it through the clear cornea here. Then you pass it through the iris. From the other end, you can use a forceps if needed to hold on to the iris. The same thing is repeated on the other side. This is one side, and then so you can see the IOL has been, the pupil has been sutured at one end, and this is then the other end where I'm trying to grasp it, and that's how it kind of looked in the end. Ideally, even the peripheral iris should be sutured like in a sewing machine kind of technique. So I think in this case, there's no question that this would be the preferred technique. So I'll just go back to my presentation. So the next patient, this patient came with a complete and total aniridia with aphakia. He had been operated elsewhere and underwent some surgery, and then now he has an ERM, and this is how he comes to us. So we decided to put in an aniridia IOL. which is an IOL which not only has the IOL in the center, but it has got the the iris, the it's got a brown. I think the two colors you can choose whichever you want. It's custom made the lens. Again, I've railroaded the suture here. Just another tip in this case is that if you see, I have first made that incision. It's around 7 mm, which I found was 6.5 mm. But then I realized later that that's not adequate. You can see I'm going back and measuring because I tried putting in the lens at initially, which did not work. You need to actually, that's the only downside I would say of using this lens. You can see the lens, how huge it is. It's around 9.5 to 10 mm, so you really need to open up the eye that much. And then pretty much it's like any other surgery, SFIOL surgery. You can see I'm still struggling because I thought that much of incision should be enough, and being a cataract surgeon, I really don't like opening up the eye too much. And then, so that's how it looked. This patient actually did really well. You know, all his photophobia issues were solved, and then the vitreoretinal surgeon took over for taking care of the ERM. He came to around 6.18, his best corrected vision. So the next case is again, it is a dropped IOL. Again, we planned an SFIOL. How much time do I have? 3 minutes? So for some reason, I'm not able to forward the videos on my presentation. So this was a dropped IOL. Pretty much, I've just done, the IOL has been grasped and removed out. And again, I've just done a 4-point fixation SFIOL. So, I think in most cases, because I said, I work in a retina center, so there would be these three ports which really help me for doing the surgery. But if you're just doing it at your setup, where you're doing a planned SFIOL, I think a tip would be to use an AC maintainer, because you don't want to keep going on putting viscoelastic in the eye. So if you are going to use an AC maintainer, I think that'll definitely work really well. So again, this is 4-point. I prefer using a 4-point, either a glued IOL or a 4-point fixation. I really feel that's a lot more stable than the so-called current techniques. Maybe at some point in the future I may update and adapt to those, but as of now I really feel this works very well in my hands, and patients are doing really well with that. So this is how it is. Like I said, you need to titrate it each time, and then you get a nice when you know that the IOL is centered, you pull it on both sides, and then you suture it, and you don't really suture, don't tie the knot too tight. So the next patient is now coming to the iris claw. Unfortunately, this is the only case of iris claw which I have the video, though we don't really have much videos of that. This was a patient where the student was trying to fixate the iris claw posteriorly, which is relatively easy once you get the hang of it, but she managed to drop that into the vitreous, and that's when we decided, because the eye was already hypotonous, so we decided to go ahead and the retina surgeon retrieved it, and we planned to go ahead and retrieve and then enclave the same iris claw into the eye. So here you can see that's the iris claw. I think it was very difficult for the surgeon to remove that. He did a good job in removing it because it doesn't have any haptic to hold on to, so it's not a very easy IOL to explant from the vitreous. So in iris claw here, of course, you need to first have a constricted pupil when you're trying to enclave it. You will grasp the IOL in the center after when you're trying to do it. And then you'll go from the either side. There is a special instrument. Either you can use that or you can use Sinsky, and then you enclave it on either side, as it's been shown here. I think in interest of time, I'm just going to go forward. This is another case. Now again, this is not really fitting into the whole gamut of SFIL versus iris claw. Just wanted to show here that there was a nucleus drop, and it was quite hard, and the surgeon delivered the nucleus into the anterior chamber. And we put in a three-piece IOL in the remaining rexus which was available. And then using the IOL as a scaffold, the remaining pieces were removed from the anterior chamber. Do I have time, or should I just? I think the surgeon here was not very confident of doing the phacofragmentome, and it also was relatively hard, and so he delivered it into anterior chamber. And somehow we felt, so I delivered most of the pieces out, and then after that I put in the IOL as a scaffold, and then we ate up the remaining pieces with a FACO. Somehow I just can't seem to forward this. Maybe I can just, yeah. Just wanted to show that. So you can do that if you're sure you have a good support. This is a technique which can also be used, you know, in case you've, like, you know, done some of your nuclear FACO and then you've had a rent or you don't want the remaining pieces to fall. That's something which you can keep in mind. And again, last case, this is a complete outlier, so Samita, don't shoot me, but this was a patient which has had a premium IOL with a multifocal IOL and a refractive surprise on week one of plus two diopters. And this was actually a very, very VIP patient. I'm not going to name him. And this is a multifocal with a plus two diopters. For some reason, I really don't know how we ended up with this, so I just wanted to show that this also, you know, technique where you have this special IOL cutting scissors. You need to make sure this, I really like the scissors, you and make sure you're not using it more than two or three times, because it then becomes blunt, and we tried doing in that, and then the IOL keeps twisting inside the eye. So you don't, make sure you adequately expand the wound, you know, don't really try and remove it through a very small, I think this is around 3 mm, and thankfully the patient did well. I took a tight suture at the end of surgery. So that's my IOL implantation. So I just want to end by saying that even though it's a Rubik cube and we are all surgeons out here, and we can and we will do so. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions from the audience? Anybody? Any questions?
Thank you so much.
Hello. Would you prefer a glued IOL or a scleral fixated IOL?
My personal preference is a scleral fixated IOL, but I think definitely a glued IOL works well. In glued IOL, the only thing is you need to be very ambidextrous and you need to be comfortable with the handshake technique. So, you know, I think if you have at least for the initial few cases, if you have a retina surgeon who can be around, you know, when you're doing the handshake technique, I think that will be good, because we've had cases where you know, it's like literally slipped and fallen into the vitreous.
And this patient with multifocal lens, when you had the refractive surprise, would you prefer to use a piggyback IOL or an IOL exchange is what you did?
No, definitely an IOL exchange.
Not a piggyback IOL?
No.
Okay.
No.
And what is the three-piece preferred IOL?
For glued IOL, I mean, no financial interest here, but I feel definitely the sensor IOL works better.
Okay.
The haptics are more, you know, they don't really damage so easily versus an Alcon IOL, but that's only my personal experience. I don't know, the audience could differ.
Thank you. That was excellent presentation. Thank you.
Just to add one thing, Auro has come up with a three-piece IOL, which is much cheaper.
Okay.
And it does very well.
Thank you.
Which one?
Auro Lab.
Yes.
I call upon next speaker, Dr. Samita Mulani, who will be talking on monovision versus multifocal IOLs. Thank you.
So, good afternoon. Unfortunately, I don't have any beautiful surgical videos for you. What I do have is a discussion about how to give the patient the best by deciding in advance. A lot of times with all these new premium IOLs and the companies promising a lot of things that some of these lenses do not actually deliver, it's very important for us to select the correct IOL for the appropriate patient. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. In our practice, almost 80 to 90% of our cataract patients are actually given monovision, and I do have data to share with you about that. And of course, there are a lot of new multifocals that have come into the market, the EDOFs that have come in that are giving bigger and better promises, but sometimes the reality is very, very different. So just taking a little look out at the way IOLs have changed over the years, from the simple non-foldable IOLs to regular spherical IOLs and three pieces, and then we have our aspheric and of course our premium lenses that a lot of us depend on. So the question here is, are we there yet? There's so many things in the market, there's so many promises. Are we really there? Some of the biggest challenges and limitations for us are patients who have diabetes may have an absolutely seemingly normal fundus, but we are assuming that something may go wrong. So we can't offer multifocal. If we want to be right about it, if we want to be, we want to live up to being true to ourselves. I know a lot of people do say we can give multifocal lenses to diabetics, but we personally don't think it's appropriate. Cost is a big issue in our country, especially insurance companies do not cover premium IOLs, so it's all coming from pocket. And with the economy being as amazing as it is right now, I think a lot of people are also thinking about spending that extra money. Night driving is a big issue with the glare and the halos right now. Of course, the new multifocals with the ads and the extended range of focus lenses are promising that there's lesser glare, lesser problem with night driving. But to be honest, we are still not seeing a perfect lens where there's 100% no glare, no halo. And of course, dysphotopsia is a very, very big issue. So how do we take a decision? How do you decide this patient is good for multifocal? A 70-year-old lady comes into your clinic. She doesn't want to wear glasses. She's diabetic. Her retina is pristine. Her sugars have been controlled well for 10 years. What do you do? What do you offer her? So what is right and what is not right? And this is where your counseling and understanding how much use for each distance is going to be important. So obviously this lady unlikely is going to drive around in the night. This lady will be reading a lot. Her intermediate and near vision is going to be the most important thing for her. So a lot of counseling, a lot of understanding which distance is the one where she needs her vision the most for is always helpful. So like I already said, the early multifocals did come with their challenges, but recently by combining multifocals, an AD4 in one eye and an AD3.25 in the other eye, we are seeing that that intermediate issue is getting reduced. And the most important thing is, even if we are giving multifocals to our patients, we are making them pay lakhs of rupees, it is very important to manage expectations. A lot of times, patients are told, they come from other places, they are told, you'll never need a pair of glasses in your life after this, don't worry. But they still need a small ad for fine work, and they are miserable. And then they say, we've paid these many lakhs of rupees, but still we are needing that addition to read the eye drop label. So the question is, it is very important and our duty as a community of ophthalmologists to under-promise and over-deliver and manage the expectations of such patients. So multifocal, we know near and distance isn't a problem, intermediate is an issue, glares and halos and dysphotopsia is an issue. These are the different kinds of glares that different lenses are providing to the patients. Some of them go away by 6 months, they don't have any issues, but a large percentage of these patients still complain, to the extent that a lot of extended range of vision patients do even come to us after a year and say, just take this lens out, I'm miserable, it's ruining my life. And we have had discussions at many platforms, national and international, where people have explanted extended range of vision IOLs as well. So it is something that you need to think about as well when you're considering the right lens for patients. So like I said, the EDOFs, they gave us a lot of promises when they came in, but then there are patients who are so miserable that they want the lens out. So we have to tell the patient that lower power ads will be required for finer vision, that halos may be there, and that promise that there are lesser halos in EDOFs may not actually be true. And dysphotopsia that is there actually even in our monofocal patients in a lot of them. So that entire field of that blinker feeling, all of those feelings are there. A lot of patients complain irrespective of multifocal or monofocal, and we need to counsel the patient that this is a possibility. So for us, our preferred technique is monovision. Monovision itself is a misnomer. It should actually probably be called mini monovision or blended vision or omnivision. And it is a very, very cost-effective alternative to giving multifocal IOLs, because there is lesser dysphotopsia, lesser complaint of glares and halo, and a top of pair of spectacles can eliminate any and all complaints that the patient may have. So some studies have studied what is the ideal difference between the two eyes when you're giving monovision. For us at our center, we usually aim for a plus 1.25 difference between the two eyes, where the dominant eye is given a plano and the non-dominant eye is given an error of about minus 1.25. If at all, when you finish your first surgery, you have not hit plano, then do not continue to plan monovision for this patient. A study that was done at Moorfields compared multifocal and monovision patients, and the monovision patients were slightly more satisfied at 85% compared to the multifocal patients that were 81. And this is great for us in our kind of practices where people don't want to spend as much, because you can tell them we are giving you the advantage of multifocal lenses without giving you an actual multifocal. So that also is something, but also you have to counsel them and tell them there is no way that you can close one eye and compare. The moment the patient compares both eyes, obviously the undercorrected eye is not going to have good distance vision. So this point has to be repeated to the patient at least 10 times before surgery. We are giving you monovision, but you cannot compare the two eyes, otherwise you will realize that one eye is not as strong as the other for distance. In our study, we've compared about 180 patients in the urban population. And basically what we have aimed for, like I said, is -1.25 difference. And our results are that in the monovision group, patients achieved a complete spectacle-free day-to-day life. 5% only were dissatisfied overall, which basically included all different symptoms of dysphotopsia, of not having the same vision in both eyes, or having dryness or any other complaints. Only one patient out of 130 complained of a problem with depth. 31.25% patients used near glasses in spite of monovision, which was mostly for fine work in 15% of them. And 6.25 patients needed glasses for driving. And 7.5% patients needed glasses for distant watching, such as TV. So these are actually really good and low percentages considering you're giving them monovision, so they are comparatively really not depending on glasses. So you can actually be promising that, but again, promise less and deliver more is always the way to go. In our multifocal group, 10% still needed glasses for very fine work and for driving. They were not comfortable without them. And 20% complained of glare, halos, and difficulty in night driving. And 10% were absolutely dissatisfied at 3 months, but by 6 months, about one third of them became okay with the glare and the halos. So this is always something that we are going to have to talk about, and you have to explain to the patient that it's a trade-off. We created a questionnaire where we asked the multifocal group and the monofocal group that if you had to recommend this lens to someone else or your relative or your sibling, what would you do? And overall, the amount of satisfaction in the monofocal group, monovision group was much higher at 9.12 out of 10, and the multifocal group had only an overall satisfaction of 7.8. So these are our principles. Always aim for -1.25 in the non-dominant eye. There are studies that say that it doesn't matter which eye you aim for, whether it's dominant or non-dominant, but this is how we do it. We prefer to do it like this. The ideal candidates for monovision are housewives, cooks, WhatsApp addicts, who don't mind putting on a pair of glasses for focused work or near work, but for most of the time don't want to be dependent on a pair of glasses. People who want crisp vision and don't mind glasses, this is your group. Patients who have a lot of night driving and don't mind putting on a pair of glasses just for driving, they are ideal for monovision. Of course, high myopes, post-refractive patients do very, very well with monovision because we can't give them multifocal. And high astigmatism, monovision with toric IOLs work beautifully, and we, most of our group, maybe 70% of our monovision group is using toric lenses. Monovision should be avoided in sports people, athletes, or those people who depend on depth perception. People who are aesthetically conscious and don't mind compromising on the quality and the halos, but they just don't want glasses, those should go into your multifocal group. And anybody with strabismus, both monovision as well as multifocal should be avoided. And if the first eye has not achieved the end result of plano or -1.25, just abandon the idea of giving monovision and try and fully correct the other eye. The advantages are cost. There's no restriction in diabetics, no loss in contrast sensitivity, no dysphotopsia, no need to explant or exchange the lens, and a top-up pair of glasses can reverse any potential complaints that a monovision patient may have. Newer ideas that we are doing is now we are trying to combine a symphony in one eye, again, no financial disclosure, and a multifocal in one eye, so that one works for intermediate and one works for near. And the results are reasonably good at present, but we don't have enough data to share it yet. And of course, the new Eyhance that has come out, it's new for all of us, and I think by the next conference, we'll all have more revelations about the Eyhance. The end result is basically it doesn't matter what lens you give your patient, just counsel the patient well, understand what the patient needs, and give them. Not necessarily that your top of the end multifocal package is what will be good for the patient. The patient may be miserable with halos. So understand your patient and give them what they want. And just to conclude, since I didn't have a video to show you, this is a patient of monovision 2 days after surgery and absolutely happy. So basically, happy patient is a happy doctor.
Thank you, Samita. That was excellent presentation. Any questions from the audience, please?
Yes, sir, please.
Ultimately, every surgeon should know how to explant the IUL. First and foremost thing you should do, because the company will always replace. Next time you go to the OT without any complication, put an IUL, cut it and take it out before you start multifocal practice. And if you really want to increase your income and want to use multifocal IULs, do not counsel your patient anything. Anything means nothing, no talk about it. Let your counselor talk, they do a better job. Because whenever I do counseling, most of the time I end up putting monofocal. Because when the patient asks you 10 questions, kehta hai, yaar, monofocal lagao, aage badho, baat khatam hai. So, agar aapka counselor counsel karta hai, whatever they have talked, you don't know what they have talked, they have promised, whatever they have done. If one odd patient in your life comes and complains, in multifocal, there are two things inbuilt. One is that if there's any problem, free of cost replacement with the monofocal. That's all patients. Any refractive error, free of cost, LASIK procedure will be done without charging a single penny. So both things are taken care of, and then don't talk too much, and your multifocal practice will increase. But if you keep on talking about it, you won't be able to increase your multifocal practice.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yes, sir, please.
Now I call upon Dr.
One
Ashish
minute.
Nagpal.
One minute.
I have a question, madam.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
I'm a retired, rather a semi-retired ophthalmic surgeon, practicing in a district place. I'm developing a cataract. I don't drive in the night. I don't need to drive in the night. What do you advise for me to have the monofocal or a multifocal or a bifocal, whatever it is? What do you advise? Frank.
Sir, any system, do you have any systemic illnesses? Any systemic illnesses?
No, diabetes.
And what is your maximum distance of work? What do you do the most in the day? Read or?
It's normal. I keep on reading once in a while.
Very simple, he's not using glasses, he'll go for multifocal. There is no discussion, no talk.
We're increasing our multifocal practice.
All those who had emetropia in young age, when they become presbyopic, even eye surgeons, they are miserable. They never use the glasses. So if any patient walks into your clinic and has got no glasses on its head, please go
then
ahead
you
and
have
do
to
the
continue
multifocal.
With
so
that.
So if he comes to me, whether monofocal, multifocal, go for multifocal. Don't have to talk about it.
I would also completely agree with that, Samita.
Yeah.
I think I would agree with Dr. Harbanshlal also that
trifocal, panoptics.
My first
choice. No financial rest. Trifocal.
Trifocal.
I have
yes.
that N6, N5. I think N6. Virtually
yes. Even for me,
thank
I
you,
think,
Dr. KPS.
Absolutely, sir. Sir, I don't think that the issue is with people with no systemic associations and no budget constraints. Of course, multifocal is the way to go.
To find out whether patient has got the money or not, it is not our job. It is for the patient to say that I don't have money.
Yes.
And sometimes you'll find absolutely poor looking.
Absolutely. We counsel for everything. We counsel for everything.
Yeah, and also another point is that unless there was a refractive surprise, I've really never had to explant a patient because they're unhappy. So they do settle down, even if patients were continuously complaining about glare and halos. In 3 to 6 months, and there was one patient who actually waited for 6 months, and she came back and then she was like, I said, do you want that lens? Are you sure? Like in the other eye. And she was like, yes, I do want that. So I've never had to explant an IOL because they were unhappy with it. So I really do recommend trifocal in this day and age for sure.
Okay, thank you.
Ma'am, one thing I want to tell you.
Yes,
otherwise, not take it otherwise. In one of your slides, you mentioned 6.25 patients. I think it could be 6.25% of patients. Yeah,
6.25% of patients.
Patients.
Yes.
Thank you.
That when I had subcapsular cataract because of the steroids, I developed 6 gram hemoglobin for no reason. From red, I became white. And nobody knew and nobody could find the reason till now. So I took the steroids and I got it cataract, subcapsular cataract. My vision was 6.9, but I could not drive well. Dr. Grover told me 10 years back that get it operated. So I got it operated this year only. And 3 rings of this lens comes on the light coming in front, but it doesn't disturb me at all. When I do direct ophthalmoscopy, I see this ring on the patient's lens, but that again doesn't disturb me. I can go to this, but I have learned to avoid it. But those rings are not very dark or anything. Hazily, you will feel that there are rings on the patient's lens.
That's very interesting. So maybe you can write a paper and publish it. So your own first-hand experience as an ophthalmologist.
Thank you, Dr. KPS. Now I call upon Dr. Ashish Nagpal, who will be talking on cataract in Fuchs endothelial dystrophy, combined surgery versus sequential surgery. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And I'd like to thank Dr. Mulani, sir, and Samita for involving me in this course. And I think we got fantastic pearls from live experiences right now. I'll just shift you to another area, a certain segment of patients who have what we call as Fuchs dystrophy, endothelial dystrophy, and also are developing cataracts. So it becomes tricky how to manage them. So what I've done is I've just created a few clinical situations. So this is one case, a 75-year-old gentleman, and you can see the edema is very obvious. So this is one situation when a patient comes to you with manifest clinical corneal edema and cataract. And the other situation would be when the patient comes for cataract and then you detect on the slit lamp that there are something on the endothelium, maybe some guttae there, and that raises a cause of concern. 15 years ago, I think there was no debate on this because we would always wait till the patient kind of had a very, very poor vision and then you would do a penetrating keratoplasty along with the cataract. And because the results were a little unpredictable and took a very long time to recover, that's why we used to delay it. But now we are discussing this in these meetings because now we have what we call as endothelial keratoplasty and we can deliver much better and faster visual outcomes. So that brings us back to this. And we know now that we are living in the era of what we call as component corneal transplant surgery, in which we can replace whatever is diseased and give faster and better results. This is just to give you an idea that how physiological the endothelial keratoplasty has become from up to down, that DMEC, it's become almost physiological way. And that is what we see in our patients also. So this is a patient who underwent a phacoemulsification with IOL and a DMEC surgery, and he recovered full. He was almost 6 parts after a month. So this is, I mean, there's a whole sea change in the way we manage these patients. So coming back to the first clinical situation, I think this case, you can see the edema, it's there, and the patient is also symptomatic. He says that he has hazy vision in the morning. So this is one important point, that a patient will complain of more hazy vision in the morning. And he may also have some symptoms of watering. Then you may suggest that let's do a specular to find out. And as you can see in this case, the left eye is the unaffected better eye, and that doesn't show, that just shows a few spots of otherwise it's fairly normal. The right eye, we couldn't even get a good capture of the endothelium because of the edema. And you cannot go just by the numbers. Sometimes you may just have a printout of the numbers and you may not be seeing the cells on the screen. So it's better not to go by the numbers, because as you can see, it shows as 2,400, which is not accurate, as it has miscalculated the image. So you should not go by the absolute numbers which come on the specular and then decide to do a procedure. And there is this the other patient situation too, in which there is no corneal edema. There is patient has come with slightly hazy vision. So what should we do? Because we do not know whether this vision is hazy because of the cataract or is it because of the cornea. So look at the pachymetry, look at the compactness of the cornea. So that will tell you. So if now the pachymetry is above 580, 600, like in this case, so then we would think of doing a combined procedure to do both phaco and this together. This is the specular of this patient. As you can see, the central specular microscopy, you can see a lot of guttae, although the endothelial cell count is pretty good. And that's what we did. This is the same case, and you can see this is the first post-op day, what it looks like. And I'll just briefly go in and show you what is the procedure like, so that we have a brief idea. It has kind of achieved, a lot of studies have already been done to compare it with endothelial keratoplasty, and it does provide much, much better visual acuity, and other complications are pretty similar. And in fact, it also offers the opportunity for us to have a longer life of the transplant, because the DMEC has shown to have less rejection up till now. It is still not completely proven yet how much less, but it is much less because probably the tissue that you transplant is much less and induces a less risk. So how is it done? I think I'll briefly in 5 minutes I'll just show you a few steps of it. So first you take the donor and remove the Descemet's membrane from the donor. As you can see, we are peeling it off. And once this is peeled off, then nowadays what we do is we mark it. You can mark it with the alphabet which is asymmetrical, like F, so that we know which side is up, which side is down, because it's a very thin membrane, and when you transplant it, it's very easy for it to turn around inside in the eye. And then once you load it, we stain it with trypan blue nicely. And then we have special injectors. There are many injectors available. This is a glass injector. And then you load this, so it becomes like a scroll. The whole membrane is like circular, but it becomes like a scroll. And then you can load it up inside a glass syringe. And once it's loaded, then you go to the patient where you have already removed the bad Descemet's, the pathologic Descemet's of the Fuchs, and then you inject it. So it goes in like a scroll. This is one of the simpler cases in which it unfolded very easily in the right direction. And once it's there, you can inject the air, and you can see the F mark, which tells us that we have put it the right side up. So this is how the procedure is done. And this is what it looks like on the next day post-op, once the Descemet's membrane is well attached, and the visual recovery is pretty fast. So to summarize, what I would say, if you have a patient of Fuchs dystrophy with cataract, and if there is any corneal edema, be it peripheral or be it central, sometimes they may have some atypical presentations, it may not be central, and if they have any visual symptoms, ask them how do they feel in the morning, if they have any blurriness which clears up as the day goes. And I would say if a pachymetry is more than 570 and above, then I would suggest that we should do a combined procedure and not risk doing a cataract first and then think of doing a transplant, because it's a very high chance that the patient, because the functionality of the endothelium is already compromised. But having said that, there are still patients who do not have any corneal edema and they may have no visual symptoms of morning blurriness, and their pachymetry may be low and they have clear compact corneas. So in these cases, one can offer a stage surgery, but I would suggest that one, it's unpredictable. We still don't know how to define these patients, which ones may decompensate, which ones may not. What if you have some intraoperative complication and damage the endothelium more? So involve the corneal surgeon or whoever is there and send the patient to them so that they can also clinically evaluate and see. Specular, to do a specular is maybe it's a medical legally necessary, it's a good thing to do. But important aspect is that the patient understands that he may need a transplant and he may need to go to another surgeon who may need to do it. So even if that happens, there is peace of mind and you can, and the patient is also aware. And having said that, I'll confuse you a little more towards the end. This is one patient. If this is the right eye of the lady who had Fuchs, and She's undergone cataract surgery by the referring surgeon very well, extremely well, and she's doing very well. But the other eye of this patient had also undergone phaco, and then she decompensated and we had to do a DSEC a few years ago. So there are situations unexplainable. They may be the same patient, in one eye phaco did well and the other eye they decompensated. So it's always good to involve a cornea referral, I would feel, and then make a decision as to what should be done. Thank you very much. I think I'll conclude there.
Wonderful talk, Ashish. I just had one comment that, you know, in that second group when you said there's no edema and the patient is not symptomatic, I would completely agree with you that to plan only cataract surgery, use a lot of, you know, maybe viscose during surgery.
Yeah.
And oftentimes, you know, you'll be surprised, but as you also said, that it's important to tell them that you are going to need a transplant in three months.
True.
Just tell them that, so if they don't need it, then they're happy. And, you know, sometimes you will be surprised for years. Like, I have a patient I'm following up for 5 to 6 years. She's maintained at 6/12, 6/9 vision, and she's happy.
True, true. I think,
so
I think all of us would have many patients with fukes, which have very bad endothelium, but they seem to be compact corneas.
Correct.
And we also see similar situations in grafts. Sometimes when we look at grafts, five-year-old grafts, they have a 400 cell count.
Exactly.
But they are absolutely compact and clear.
Yeah.
But we don't know. There may be a subgroup of fukes who behave like this, but till we know how to identify them.
Yeah, and until I think you're an absolutely skilled DMEC surgeon, I would still think it's in these kind of cases best to just do cataract first.
So if suppose somebody does not have access to the keratoplasty, DMEC or something, so he should do a cataract surgery and send it to the corneal surgeon.
Yes.
Any modification in the biometry needs to be done.
Yes.
I mean, do these patients become after surgery? Suppose patient was emetropic and you do DSEC, whether they become plus or minus. So that suppose I'm doing a cataract, I'm not doing cornea. And if I want to refer the patient after doing a cataract surgery, whether I should keep patients slightly on the minus side or the plus side.
True, sir. So I think that's a very important point that you raised. So if in these times, DSEC usually does cause a hyperopic shift. So that from that perspective, you should try and make it counteract for that. But with a DMEC, it seems to be fairly neutral in most surgeons' hands. It doesn't seem to have any refractive impact.
Yes.
Are the corneal surgeons able to get DMEC in the first go, or they need to waste few corneas? I mean, because once in a while we have seen a live surgery and the surgeon attempted three times and wasted three cornea before he could get the DMEC graft. So whether most of them are now competent enough to get the DMEC, or is still
I think a lot of us, I think with the main thing which changed the course of DMEC was the stamping. So now there was no unpredictability which side is up.
Yes.
And
definitely.
I think as time is going, we are having a lot of workshops and training. I think a lot of us are becoming more and more proficient in DMEC.
Yes,
now.
I agree. And if you're referring,
but it has a long learning curve. You're right.
Surgeon who's doing DSEC, then definitely aim for at least one to one and a half diopters of myopia for
one
sure.
And a half diopter.
Yes, one diopter for sure.
So it is. Is it the amount of phaco energy that you have used that it makes the cornea vulnerable for decompensation, or?
Sorry.
Is the amount of phaco energy that you have used?
Yeah, so of course, I mean, as we know, even in a normal situation, if we use a certain phaco energy which can damage the endothelium, some of them will have edema which may persist for a longer time till the endothelium migrates and recovers.
So on these grounds, can you say that flax will do better in such cases?
Flax, I'm unaware. I don't think there has been any proven way to show that it reduces the endothelial cell damage. But yes, there may be certain, if you're doing it regularly, there may be certain hard cataracts, which it may reduce to some components.
Flax has got no role whatsoever in protection of the endothelium.
Sir, I'll just share one.
Just
experience.
All these studies have shown, and any time you do any procedure in the eye, endothelial loss is going to take place, and it is how nicely and how well you do your surgery that is more important.
Sir,
how away from the cornea, how much your viscose is there, these all things, I mean, and the plaque itself causes a lot of inflammation. So this plaque, and if you just do a little bit of aspiration closer to the cornea is gone in any case, whether it's a flax or non-flax. So it makes no difference.
So,
it is the awareness in your mind that I got to be away from the cornea and take all the precautions. That is more important than anything else, whatever, whether it's a Jepto, whether it's a Flax or anything else.
So just to share one experience.
So these cases are usually not a hard cataract. All these patients, posterior polar, the folks dystrophy, these are usually soft cataract. And a soft cataract, Flax is not going to make much of a difference.
So just to share an experience, I did one eye surgery in a patient who I was not knowing that he is having effuse dystrophy. And the post-op period, he had this decompensation of cornea. And then the patient went to another surgeon who has this facility of Flax. So he did a femto-assisted cataract surgery for the same patient. Obviously, the other eye which he did was having less amount of cataract. The nucleus sclerosis was less in that. But the patient is doing fine for last 8-9 months now.
No. So that is that if you're not aware of the corneal pathology, in any case, you didn't do a good surgery from the first place itself. I mean, you should have picked up at least on a slit lamp, there are some changes. You didn't take the precaution you should have taken while you were doing a surgery, and then your cataract was harder. So the precaution in taking surgery is more important than doing a Flax.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Next, we have Dr. Navindu Rai. He's a retina surgeon, and he'll be talking to us about the anterior vitrectomy from the limbal root or the pars plana root, hopefully with respect to only anterior segment surgeons. Navindu.
Thank you, sir. Desi topics and desi attire. That was the idea of our chief instructor, Dr. Mulani, sir. So at the outset, I would like to thank AIOS, Dr. Mulani, sir, Samita, and everybody for giving me a chance to speak in front of this August gathering. I'll be speaking on the two sides of anterior vitrectomy, limbal root versus the pars plana root, and hope I'll be able to do justice to both of them. The posterior capsule is the thickest basement membrane of our body, and it stretches to 60% of its circumference before it gets ruptured. The types of precedent can be intrasurgical, like accidental or planned PCC. It can be pre-existing or a spontaneous one. Now, our job is, if we have a precedent, we need to reduce or stop it from enlarging. Because if it enlarges, the prognosis becomes poorer. So what are the events leading to accidental PCR? They are during IA, which is the most common one. Extension of radial tears, large leaky wounds, vigorous hydrodissection, during removal of last fragment of nucleus, during intraocular lens implantation and dialing, incomplete capsular access in which tags of anterior capsule can be caught into the probe, hydroprolapse of nucleus through a very small access, manipulation in the back without adequately pressurizing the anterior chamber, during polishing of the posterior capsule or by direct hit by phaco probe, chopper or dialer. Now, how to recognize it? There could be a sudden deepening of the anterior chamber, or what we call it as a snap sign, which is momentary dilatation of the pupil, sudden brightening of the frontal globe, or the nucleus now paradoxically moves away on aspiration, sways sideways, or flatters away from the probe. Or you can be sure if a part of nucleus or the whole of the nucleus goes in the posterior vitreous cavity. So for the management of PC rank, the first thing is do not panic. If you panic, your management becomes more problematic. The first thing is maintenance of anterior chamber throughout the management of post-PC rent is of prime importance. If the chamber is not maintained, the more vitreous will come in the anterior chamber, increasing the size of the rent. First and foremost, do not withdraw the phaco probe in hassle. First, inject dispersive viscoelastic with the non-dominant hand, and this is what you need to practice in your routine phaco. Use your non-dominant hand. We vitreoretinal surgeons are used to use both the hands, but a cataract surgeon is usually poor with the non-dominant hand, and he has to, there are people who can do better phacos with both the hands, but still you need to practice. You need to make your non-dominant hand work when required. So first you inflate the back with the viscoelastic and then you withdraw the phaco probe. Now it is important to confirm the presence of vitreous prolapse, because if it is there, you need anterior vitrectomy, and this is what we are going to discuss. So how to recognize presence of vitreous? You can either sweep a sponge or swab stick along the side of incision. You can use a spatula and sweep in the anterior chamber from the main wound towards the iris. Now these two are dangerous. Why? Because the other part of the vitreous is attached to the base, which is very strong attachment. And when you are doing this, you are going to call upon more problems, more complications in post-op. The best way is just use a sheet over a ghost. The vitreous is a ghost, and we are putting some triamcinolone particles to visualize it. That is the best way to recognize the presence of vitreous. From 61, David Kashner, he started performing open sky vitrectomy. It is particularly dangerous. And why it is dangerous, we just discussed about it, because of the strong permanent vitreoretinal adherence at the vitreous base, but and the vitreous base, the retina at the vitreous base is of the tensile strength 1/100th of the posterior retina. So this should be obsolete, but still people are using it. The second thing to discuss is the anterior vitrectomy through limbal route. Cataract surgeons are familiar with working from and around limbus. If vitreous prolapse is minimal and PCR is central, this could be a preferred approach. In this, the vitreous is pulled anteriorly. Now, this pull, anterior pull is reduced if you increase the cut rate. But still, there is a very minimal amount of pull anteriorly. And if you are pulling the vitreous anteriorly, there can be some chances of posterior, complications in the posterior cavity, like formation of retinal tears, dialysis, etc. Although it is very less, but still it is there, theoretically. Now it is done through the side port incisions so that the chamber becomes a closed one. We'll just discuss this video in which now we get a rent over here. The surgeon is using his non-dominant hand to first inflate the bag with viscoelastic. And after that, the probe is removed outside. Do not panic. Most important, do not panic. Take some time, plan the surgery, and then go ahead. While removing, doing a dry aspiration. Now see, some part of the vitreous got caught in the cannula, and you require a vitrectomy. And you see this, the port of the cutter is facing upwards. So when you're using a limbal route, the port of the cutter, it faces upwards so that you do not damage the other parts of the eye, like iris, the remaining of the anterior capsule, posterior capsule. And then slowly, with the vicious cycle of dry aspiration, viscoelastic, and vitrectomy, you complete the case. At the end, again, you do some vitrectomy and then the rest of the procedures, depending on the size of the rent and position of the rent, you decide which eye will put. So, to the past planar route, you can either make a stab incision 3 mm away from the limbus using an MVR blade, or alternatively, you can use a 23 gauge or 25 gauge Tokka cannula system for this. So, in this, by doing vitrectomy for the past planar route, we are basically the vitreous is being pulled posteriorly, and hence the pressure or the pull on the vitreous base is minimal, and that is why we call it more physiological. In this video, now we have a PC rent and then a 3 millimeter is marked from the limbus, and using a Tokka cannula. If you don't have a Tokka cannula, you can make a sclerotomy with a MVR blade, 20 gauge MVR blade. And then the only thing that I want to discuss in this is, while first thing, that the limbal route is being used for irrigation, and the cutter port is facing downwards. While we were using the limbal route, it was facing upwards, but now we are facing downwards because we do not want to disturb the rest of the posterior capsule, zonules and everything. So rest of the things, they are same. So it is physiological because it is the safest amputation. The vitreous is basically being amputated, and it is being severed from any attachment to the anterior chamber. So, and it is specially suited for large vitreous loss, vitreous behind the iris, zonular dehiscence, and PCR after or during IOL implantation. Other indications could be when the anterior vitrectomy is planned preoperatively, like in secondary IOL implantation, post-traumatic or subluxated cataract with prolapsed vitreous, or dry vitreous trap in severely crowded anterior chamber or posteriorly misdirected fluid syndrome. The only contraindication is if you're not able to visualize the vitrectus tip to the pupil, do not go ahead with past planar. Now, which one is better? The two techniques are not mutually exclusive. The decision to use the NTIA approach versus a past preliminary approach may depend on the likelihood of enlarging the tear in the posterior capsule or unzipping of zonules. And it also depends on surgeon's comfort zone. There was a comparison between the two routes, and the study concluded that the pars plana appears to be a more efficient alternative to limbal route. It requires less surgical time, removing less vitreous, and maintaining capsular integrity. Why? Because the vitrector is posterior to the prolapsed vitreous and capsular end, thus minimizing the amount of vitreous removed and likelihood of capsular damage. Traditionally, anterior segment surgeons are more comfortable working in their familiar territory, that is the anterior chamber. But using the pars plana approach may at first be daunting to the cataract surgeon, but newer technology like newer phaco machines, better vitrectors, and sutureless trocar systems make it easier. Limbal route also gives very good results, provided the following three scenarios are taken care of. If the surgeon places the cutting port too anteriorly, then there will be pull on the vitreous. If the surgeon uses a coaxial vitrectomy with a single hand pick, that is also not very physiological. If the surgeon tolerates leaky limbal wounds, then the chances of increasing the size of PC rent is more. One thing off, Stephen Charles has said that for pars plana vitrectomy, for anterior vitrectomy, we should forego the trocar cannula because some pressure is required to introduce this trocar cannula, which is less if we use a MVR blade. And the eye is already soft. The more you pressurize it, there are more chances that the vitreous will come in the anterior chamber and increase the size of rent, and then the final result will be poorer. So just to compare both these procedures, the limbal route is easier for anterior segment surgeons, while they need to change their mindset for a pars plana one. It is done through usual side port entries. Pars plana requires extra stab incision. The cutter port faces upwards in limbal while it faces downwards in the pars plana route. Complications in limbal could be enlargement of PCR, trauma to the endothelium, iris anterior posterior capsule, or retinal breaks leading to RD. While complications in pars plana route could be port related, like retinal breaks, dialysis leading to RD, suprachoroidal hemorrhage, or damage to the zonules or posterior capsule. Contraindications for limbal route are vitreous behind the iris because we won't be able to reach to that site, and zonular dehiscence because then it will start unzipping. Contraindication for pars plana is poor visibility of cutter port to the pupil. This is a self-explanatory video.
Through the rent in the posterior capsule, you can see that as much vitreous is coming forward from the vitreous body as what I am removing anteriorly. And as we withdraw, there's often a wisp to the incision, as you might see at the slit lamp the next day. Now we're going to intentionally break the capsule and plan a posterior incision through the pars plana. And Kenalog or triessence is particulate identifying, and the moment we pull out with our other instrument, you can see that vitreous followed. And now we're going to go through the pars plana, still with irrigation anteriorly, but pars plana below. We've amputated our anterior posterior attachments. On the one side, it actually removed the vitreous from the incision. On the other, you can see there's no traction when we go to sweep it from the wound because there's no further attachment.
So while using the pars plana route, the vitreous was actually amputated. So there was no connection between the anterior, the vitreous that came in the anterior chamber, and the one which is there in the posterior vitreous cavity. So there's no pull on the vitreous base, and so less chances of complication. In 2014, there was an audience poll in which they were asked those in attendance how would they deal with the vitreous loss, and 70.9% of them said they will perform bimanual anterior vitrectomy to the limbal route. 20.5 said that they will be doing the same with a single this one cannula. And only 6% of them said that they will use a pars plana route for the anterior vitrectomy. And thankfully, the people who said they will use a sponge vitrectomy was only 2.60. So I think I was able to help you all to get you out of fear of the past planar anterior vitrectomy.
Thank you, Navindu. I'd like to thank all the speakers and the delegates for attending this session. Any questions, please?
Yeah, just